involved with empowering underprivileged children since 2007. There is a great need for channelizing the potential of children from these backgrounds of society. The PIFA Foundation empowers these children by giving them exposure to high-level competitions like the one we did today. And girls' football and taking the women's football team to the World Cup is my top priority.
And this is only with the help of Hefele, Hefele Bayern Partnership and with PIFA.
Welcome to the Hefele Indian Women's Football webinar. Today we are joined by a very distinguished panel of guests who are going to enlighten us on sports education and sports management related education. As this phenomena of women's football and football in India grows, they're going to require an army of administrators, entrepreneurs, managers who will guide everyone on doing a really fantastic job so that India can actually rank somewhere in world ranking. So without further ado, I would like to introduce my panelists today, starting with Shail Kapri from the AIFF Masters Program. Shail, over to you.
Hi, everyone. I'm happy to see all of you today over here. I think everyone has removed time on a Saturday at 4 o'clock, and I think there is some sense of webinar fatigue which has crept in, I think, in everyone. So I believe that a question and answer in a small group like this is much more inclusive and is the best way to optimize your time that you're investing today. So that said, I and my colleagues in All India Football Federation exist to support any aspirations of football lovers. So feel free to ask any questions over the next 2 hours and we would love to answer.
Over to you, Bela. Bela, please unmute yourself. Yeah. Bela, please unmute yourself.
Is this okay?
Yeah, perfect. Yes. Perfect, Bela.
Sorry about that. Good evening, everyone. Anjali, at the outset, thank you for having us all over. Seems like an interesting discussion for all the participants with almost all the stakeholders being here from different streams. So look forward to interesting discussion. Thank you.
Amol?
Hi, all. Anjali, first of all, I'm grateful to be on this panel. Thanks for inviting me over. And, you know, the other panelists, I usually see them on LinkedIn, and this is the first time probably I'm interacting with them in person. So thanks for organizing this, and thanks to Hefele as well for being the sponsor. We all understand the importance of sponsorship. So, you know, it's good to have such sponsors supporting such events. And we as sports management institutes are always there to serve the community and the sports people and like-minded people. So it's good to have this interaction, and we are happy to answer any questions.
Amit?
Hi, good afternoon. Anjali, thanks for inviting me on the panel. I represent International Institute of Sports Management, which is incidentally covering 10 years of creating sports management professionals in the Indian industry. More than happy to be here with everybody and answer all the questions that the participants will have. Thanks.
Ruben?
Right. At the outset, thank you, Anjali and PIFA Foundation, for having me represent the Global Institute of Sports Business. I think you hit the nail on the head when you spoke about us needing, requiring an army to get India at that top level. And having my fellow panelists from various sports management institutes only echoes that fact that we just, you know, we need many more sports management discussions, talks, and institutes mushrooming in the next few years to make India a sporting nation. So, very happy to be here, and thank you so much for having me.
And Vineet?
Thanks a lot, Anjali, for having us over here. I'm Vineet Rukhani from NASM Academy of Sports Management. And like I think one of the panelists mentioned, it's great seeing all the stakeholders of sports management, at least from Mumbai, being present over here. And more than ever, I think there is a need of collaboration and cooperation amongst the sports industry. And happy to be here.
Excellent. I would like each of you to give a small brief on the courses offered by your institute, whether it's a presentation, whether it's a video, before we start any questions. So we can start off with you, Vineet.
So yeah, so at NASM, Academy of Sports Management, we are, as a group, we are a 2-decade-year-old institute, having been, serving in new age careers in collaboration with various universities. We are present currently in 4 cities in India, and in 1 international country in UAE, in Dubai, and offering, bachelor's and master's program in sports management, the two-year master's program in sports management. All these are in collaboration with different state universities. For example, in Mumbai, the degrees are awarded by the Mumbai University, and we are in collaboration with the Nagindas Khandwala College in Malad in Mumbai. And similarly, in various other cities, we are there with different sports universities or different state universities for that matter. So offering 3-year full-time bachelor programs or 2-year master programs. Those are full-time courses. Apart from that, we also have the diploma programs. So, for on a part-time basis, where those are more so for working professionals or students who are already pursuing other qualifications.
Excellent. Amit, next.
Yeah, IISM offers 4 programs basically. We have our bachelor's program, which is a 3-year program that is post your 12th standard. Master's program for postgraduate level. This is in collaboration with the University of Mumbai, of course. We also offer 2 PGP programs, that is postgraduate programs for working professionals. One is sports and wellness management, and the newly launched sports event management, which is kicked off from this year itself. So we get students across the country on our campus in Mumbai, the new campus that's recently opened a year back. We get them on that campus in Mumbai. Thanks.
Bela or Amol, whoever would like to take on the introduction.
So I represent Graysales Education. Graysales is the umbrella brand, and the brands that we run include not just sports management, but we set the trend in India and the UAE for industry-relevant training, starting with a brand called EMDI, which is almost synonymous with event management training in India and Dubai. We have our own campus in Dubai, in Knowledge Village, right from 2014. In India, we've had a presence since 2002 with the brand. This engagement and the steps of EMDI got us into launching almost over a decade back India's premier and first ever program in sports management. So to that extent, Graysales as promoter has been the pioneer in launching sports management in India. Similarly, we pioneered sports management in Dubai also as an industry-relevant program. Over the years, it's been a very enriching experience. The support that we got from the industry, from alumni, we have probably 8,500 plus global alumni across the media and entertainment sector. So I'm not just talking sports management, but all our alumni are very well placed. And of course, Amol can give more detailing at senior levels of media houses and not just sports management companies. So it's great. We also offer PG programs. We, I think, probably offer a very unique offering in the PG program for a global course where students have the opportunity to intern and not just visit a country, but intern with the global events in the Middle East. So in the past, our students who opted for the program have had the opportunity to intern and get hands-on experience with marquee events like the Formula One, the Rugby Sevens, and many others in UAE, which has been an unexperienced and unparalleled experience for students. This year, we also offer a bachelor's program in all the three streams, sports management, event management, and marketing management. I just add to this, the beauty of the campus is students get to interact with like-minded students from different streams and not just focus on a vertical of sports management. So that also adds to their professional growth. Amol can add more if he wants on this. Amol, over to you.
Yeah, so I represent IMU Sports Management Global Academy, which is a part of Gracell's education. And we have been in the space for the last 5 years. And of course, Gracell's has been in the space of education for over a decade. Within Ironwood Sports Management for the last 5 years, we have been offering postgraduate diploma in sports management and postgraduate diploma in global sports management. These are basically courses for graduates. And the students who choose the global course, they get to intern in Dubai. We have an institute in Dubai for the last 10 years. So students who choose the global sports management, they get to intern in Dubai for two months. And so this year we are launching bachelor's, as Bela pointed out. We are launching bachelor's in sports management and also diploma in sports management. And I'm happy to say that, you know, over the last 5 years, we got an excellent placement record in the sports companies out there. And so we are looking forward to launching or, you know, taking off the bachelor's program very soon.
Ruben?
Yes, so just to introduce myself, my name is Ruben. I head marketing and industry relations for the Global Institute of Sports Business. To give you a quick brief, GISB, which is the abbreviation, the GISB basically offers an industry design and internationally certified postgraduate program in sports management with the aim to create leaders in the sports industry. So two key pillars in the previous statement that I spoke about is, one is industry design, right? So we are the brainchild in the education vertical of the existing sports management agency, which is India on Track. So our management has come with a lot of experience and backing from the sports industry itself. All of us have had previous experience working in various verticals across grassroots development, consultancy, data, content publishing as well. Various parts of the sports industry, and we saw that there is a requirement for a program like this and a gap like this. Secondly, all faculty at the GISB teaching are professionals in sports, right? So we have a 100% visiting faculty model where each and every module and subject is taught by a professional who excels in that particular field. So they actually come down to the campus and they teach our students in various subject matter that they excel in. So it not only gives them a first-hand, gives our students a first-hand experience of learning from a professional, but also gets them to know about real-life case studies and also network with professionals from the sports industry. Thirdly, we also affiliate with a host of sports companies. So we are affiliated with a lot of sports companies in India and abroad as well, which I'll speak about later. But the idea is to provide live project experiences, internship opportunities, and also have, you know, students work with a lot of sports professionals and understand what it really is like to be working in the sports industry. The second pillar that I spoke about, which is the internationally certified program, is that we are partnered with the University of Massachusetts Amherst. So this is the number one sports management program in the world for more than 40 years now. So what UMass provides is not only just a certification, but their PhD professors also fly down to India and teach three subjects in strategy, in marketing, consumer behavior, and market research, and leadership in sport. Apart from that, our students also have access to case studies from the McCormick Department of Sports Management, which Mark H. McCormick is a leader in sports management. He's the man behind IMG, right? Apart from that, a very strong industry connect, notably with the Premier League. We're affiliated with the Premier League, where our students actually spend a week for a study trip in London, understanding about the branding, marketing, different pieces of the Premier League clubs, community development as well. It provides them an understanding of how one of the top leagues in the world actually function and what are the standards and professionalism that they bring in while executing their league. Apart from that, all the activities that the Premier League undertakes in India, so more recently, you must have heard that the under-14 teams of Chelsea and Manchester United and Southampton came down for a Premier League Next Generation Games tournament. So we actually, we cancel all classes for that week. We don't schedule classes, and our students work in various parts of the engagement that Premier League undertakes, which includes, you know, activation with Alan Shearer, which is ambassador, or, you know, looking at fan development, or looking at, various pieces, working with Reliance Young Stars and other ISL teams. And just to share a little bit about the program, it's a 15-month postgraduate program. So you have 12 months of classroom and curriculum-based learning. And then you move on to a three-month guaranteed internship period where we actually intake a very small batch of students because we believe in mentoring them and helping students to actually work in a field that is more that's combined with their passion and their interest, so that it's not only just about picking up an internship, but it's also trying to convert that internship into a full-time opportunity. So yeah, that's a quick brief.
Last but not least, Shail.
Thank you so much, Anjali. So firstly, I don't know if people know that there are three amazing visionaries of the industry on this call. So one, of course, is Nirvan. I don't know how many of you know that Nirvan is one of the, if you were to think about doing professional courses of any kind of certification, I think Nirvan has probably ticked every checkbox. He studied everything. He studied in the UK when there were no options available in India. And he's been a huge driving force. And of course, Anjali has mirrored that exceptionally well on the women's side. And most appropriately, I can't think of anyone else who could be steering a conversation of this sort. So I think, first of all, Anjali, great initiative. And the kind of work you continue to do with AIFF is phenomenal. And I think there's a long way to go on that. Secondly, we have Bela Desai. So Bela is actually a true visionary. She's the one who actually started, she backed the entire initiative of sports management in our country. And then, of course, pairing up with Deepak Chaudhary and Nilesh Kulkarni, that's how she launched out IISM. But Bela, it's again a rare opportunity for many of us to have you, because you can share so many insights. And today what sports needs is a great amalgamation of finance and that kind of visionary thought. And so I think we're very fortunate in that sense. I'm just a worker. I work in All India Football Federation on the education side. We've been doing education for the last 4 or 5 years at the state level first. We tried out at the VIFA level, became a huge success, and now we're rolling it out. So that's what it is. All India Football Federation has coaching programs, education programs, and now this is another program called AIFF Masters. Anjali?
Thanks so much, El. Nirvan is thanking you. For those of you who don't know, Nirvan's my better half and the inspiration behind PIFA and everything PIFA does. And Nirvan and my son are my team for this entire webinar. So yeah, and Nirvan himself has studied abroad, and both my sons have done sports management. But at that point, when I sent my older son to UK in 2011, there weren't any options here, no full-time options. So my older son has actually done sports management in Coventry, and the younger one has done football studies and business at Southampton. Yeah, so we are a full family of football enthusiasts. And today, I think it's really important that I have got all the masters of the industry to guide everyone how sports management can actually make a difference in the sport in the country, and particularly the women's sport. So does anyone have any presentation they would like to share before we get to the questions?
I'm good. No, that's it.
Okay, all fine. Okay, so there's no doubt that the sports industry is one of the largest growing industries in the country. You know, with 50% of India's population being under 25 years and 65% of it being under 35 years, sports, fitness, and entertainment are the three big industries that are going to become very, very, very prominent in the near future. First of all, I think all of us also have one very big job to do, which is actually get recognition as an industry, you know. So I think we all should also put our efforts in reaching out to the government and getting the tag of an industry, sports industry. It will make so things so much easier for everybody. I'm going to start off with the first question to Bela or Amol, whoever would like to take that question. What role do you see a sports management industry playing in the development of women's football?
Thank you,
suggest Amol, you want to take this?
Yeah,
Amol.
So, you able to hear me?
Yeah,
okay. So I will divide this question into two parts. One is about what role does a sports management institute play in the development of a sport than maybe football or cricket? You know, all those students who take admission in sports management institute like us and others, they basically fall in two categories. One category are active sports people who, you know, who want to make a career in sports. And the second categories are those, you know, who have never played a sport, but they want to be in the sports industry because they are really passionate about it. So when I look at these two categories, after they graduate from a sports management institute, they would be a working force. They would either join a sports company or they could start something of their own. In the 1 year or 3 years that they invest with a sports management institute like us, we expose them to a lot of different aspects and dimensions. So we have faculty coming in from the industry who share real case studies, who share their experiences, take them through the highs and lows of being in the sports industries. And we also provide them internship opportunities, which gives them a first-hand experience of what it takes to be successful in a sports company. So during this phase of 1 year or 3 years of whatever duration they are in the sports management institute, it's an opportunity for us as a sports management institute to channelize their passion, to guide them, and, you know, make them successful in their respective goals. So for example, a student could say, okay, I want to be, let's say, in a cricket company. What I advise to them as a sports management institute is probably, you know, it's better to have a 360-degree view of the sports industry than be very limited or have a narrow vision of just being in one sport, because they are too early to start off being fixated with one sport. It's important for them to have a very holistic view of various sports. So I can give you a very great example an example of a student who was a cricketer. And, you know, when he came to counseling to us, he said that I want to be in the cricket company. I want to make my career in cricket itself. I could sense that probably because of his cricket experience, he wanted to be in the cricket company itself. But after, you know, after 10 months of his education in Ironwood Sports, we thought that he's right cut out for an operations role, and maybe not for a cricket company because it's still not ready for it, but for, let's say, marathon. So we sent him for an interview. He was a bit hesitant, you know, initially about whether he should take up that opportunity with a marathon company because he comes from a cricket background. You know, 3 months down the line, he called me up saying, Amol, I'm really happy to be with this marathon company, and I'm never ever going back to cricket because I'm so happy, and marathon has given me so much as compared to cricket. So as a sports management institute, I think it's very important. This is my view, that we should look at their passion, their interest, and also guide them. So it's not about one specific sport in my mind. And of course, you know, if someone is passionate about football, sometimes in life, we never had any kind of degree in sports management. We all come from different backgrounds. I, for my example, you know, I come from BSc Mathematics, and look at where I am right now in sports. So in life, we have to take detours. So when you graduate from a sports management institute, I think it's very important for a student to not be fixated with one sport, have a very holistic view. And that is exactly the kind of work that we do as a sports management institute. And we are also, you know, we are very friendly with our students. In fact, the alumni who has been passed out from the last 5 years, they are still in touch with me, and we help them with different opportunities. I know that, you know, for example, if a student who wanted to be in football, but he has taken a detour and started off with a different sport, and if I know of any other opportunity, then we of course bounce it off with him and we help him reach to his goal. But, you know, at an overview, I think I'm repeating this, but it's important that students, when they set off at this age, it's important to have a very holistic view, a 360-degree view, and not just be fixated with one sport. Yeah, Jay. Sorry, Anjali, we can't hear you.
Amit, what is your take on this?
Yes, students from all different, you know, sporting fields. Incidentally, we have 70% of our students who are sports person, active sports person, either playing or have played. We have few international representations as well. So yes, we do get, and we are talking about women participation here. We do try and you know, ensure that they kind of explore all the opportunities which are available. But saying this, we have our own in-house sports festival called Junoon, which is a football fest. It's a football fest by the students, for the students, as I prefer to call it. And our students actively are involved in the complete execution of this event. So what we try and do is we ensure that the whatever the students that we have, female students that we have, they participate actively in this, whether it is getting the sponsorships, whether it is, you know, manning the complete operations. In fact, you name it, it is security that they are into. They have been to various companies and got sponsorships. They have drawn the lots. So everything that you can, you know, think of in a sports, football kind of a scenario, our students get into it. Apart, this is a live exposure that they get. This goes on for nearly 3 months. We have, this year we had close to 24 colleges which participated. So from my point of view, it's a great exposure to these girls. Apart from that, yes, we get lots and lots of internship opportunities. We get it from various industries, whether it is marathon, whether it is cricket, whether it is swimming, various. So I can't really name them all, but yes, from various opportunities are exposed to. And at the end of the whole thing, it is their choice on what exactly they want to pursue their career in. We also have an entrepreneurship development cell, which is chaired by our associate dean. So he encourages participation of female students in this entrepreneurship cell. They also are, you know, kind of encouraged to get into writing of papers. I personally feel that more research that you do, more knowledge that you get about the industry. Incidentally, ISM publishes one of its kind research papers, the only sports research paper called SARJ, which is again in partnership. We have editors like Mr. Vinit Karnik, we have Professor Ratnakar Shetty on the editorial board, along with Mr. Amitabh Pal, who is our associate dean. So our female students are encouraged to be a part of this. And the whole idea is for them to what lies out there, what lies in the sports industry, what can they do to contribute to the sports industry. And yes, that's something that we try to do and encourage the female participants that we have.
Fantastic. Ruben, what would you like to add to this question?
Yeah, so I just want to take a step back and just talk about sports management in you know, from the outset. When you look at the need for sports management, it has come in with sports becoming a viable commercial property to sell, right? There's more money been pumped into sport over the past 10 years with the IPL starting in, you know, 12 years ago. But before that, there was no real option for anyone who loved sport to sort of study it in India and take it up as a viable career option. On the management side, that is. Now that there is so much of you know, in influx of money out there from a commercial standpoint, through different leagues, different sports, through a lot of foreign interest in sport in India, you need specialized professionals to take up these positions. If you see the earlier wave of sports professionals, not many actually were lucky to study sports management, because you either had to study abroad and come back, or else you had to get into the industry and learn as you went forward. Now, when we're looking at an industry which is, you know, every year getting more and more professional, you need the right kind of people who've studied. You need to have studied the Olympics movement. You need to study what are the various laws of FIFA. You need to study how the ICC works. What is the structure of BCCI, etc., to understand when you get into the sports industry. And whether it is you're working grassroots or working at a federation or a private company, you have to understand how all the entire ecosystem works to make strategic calls and strategic decisions. With coming back to your question with regards to development of women's football, I think now is, I mean, there's no better time right now than right now for women women to take up sports management in India and how sports management can help development for women's sport in India. If you look at, even if you look at the last 12 months, right, with, the Bala Devi transfer to the Rangers, you look at, the FIFA Under 17 World Cup, Women's World Cup now moving into India. There's so much of movement, there's so much of traction right now in the women's football community that it's incredible that all these sports management professionals and students who will get into the industry are going to help get up the sport and make it even bigger. I mean, there's a very, very strong chance that from all the five institutes here, almost 50-60% of all the students here will be participating in some directly or indirectly for the FIFA Under 17 World Cup that takes place next year, right? And that itself is such an important piece of the puzzle to put, for the growth of women's football in India. So, yeah. I think you're on mute, Anjali.
Shell, what are your views on your institute's offering to women to increase this game in India?
Yeah, I think first of all, Anjali, great question. Like, what can sports institutes do to promote Indian women's football? So I think the answer lies in a movie called Dangal. Okay, I know I'm giving a wrestling example for football. And the answer is this, that imagine that they made Dangal with two young boys. I mean, Dangal was not a story of two young girls, but two young boys. So suddenly waking up in the morning, having Pani Puri, going for a run, doesn't sound exciting anymore, right? Because you expect young boys to do that. So I think what Dangal showed us is that the power of storytelling, is so strong that it can inspire so many young girls to take it up. And I think that's what is missing. I think sports institutes have a tremendous opportunity of using the vast resources that they have. They've got these talented youngsters who have joined, who are dedicating between 1 to 3 years of their life just to be in that ecosystem of sports. If they can tell these multiple stories, if instead of just trying to go to an event and just look cool wearing a accreditation badge and hanging around in the field of play, if they can actually create content, tell these stories. So again, one more example I would like to say over here is that of Megan Rapinoe. So Megan Rapinoe is like the face of US women's football team. And she's done an exceptional performance. And she was also very articulate in the way the women's team was fighting the men's side in terms of revenue, in terms of that they're not getting paid as much. Of course, they lost that particular case, but that case will keep coming back again and again because parity has to happen. So why these two examples of Dangal and of Megan Rapinoe is because in India, women are not treated at the same level as men. Like, they're just not. The day we start not doing any gender preference or gender disparity, that's going to be the day when women's football, and that only will happen through these narratives. So one more last example I want to say on this is, imagine a situation where about 15 boys and girls in each of these sports management institutes create a vertical which just chronicle stories from districts, from different states of challenge, of adversity, and of skill. Because the problem is when we look at men's football and we look at women's football, we're trying to compare the speed, the strength, the stamina. Those are not apples and versus oranges also. In fact, that's like apple versus elephant. So you need to look at the individual skills, and that's where you can truly have great comparative stories of superb skill in women's football and superb skill in men's football. Unless we do these things, I think it's very easy for people to say, but why should I watch women's football? Why should I? So all these students in all our institutes are not waking up at 5 in the morning or going to bed at 3 in the night to watch women's football. They have no idea if women's football is happening also or not. So just to make sure this is not a moot conversation, I feel that it will be good if we have some sort of, I think there was a great point which I think Vineet mentioned, that it's a small industry, we all are in the same ecosystem. So if we band together and pool together, I think women's football, because for example, the kind of network which Anjali has created in FIFA has everything. The whole infrastructure exists. The kind of outreach program is all there. I think the only thing needed is the right kind of resources to assist her. So I think that's my point of view. Great narrative, great storytelling of our women heroes.
Lovely. It's great to hear that. I personally am a big fan of storytelling and getting the message across through stories. Shell, tell us a little more about the AIFF Masters program and what it is going to offer general students.
So, I'll need to go a little bit in my background. So, 11 years ago, I started working with IISM. And at that time to this time, the ratio of women in sports management has more or less been the same. It has been. And the more away you go from grassroots, the less the number of girls who join. So if you look at all the master's programs, they'll have less number of girls as against the, say, the bachelor's program. So at the AIFF Masters, So let's look at our coach education program at AIFF. The coach education program now this year starts from E-certificate. So what we call as the D license, C license, but actually it's a certificate programs of coaching. So in that, you will always see literally single digit percentage of girls participating in that. And the same thing holds true as you move forward to the program. So the AIFF Masters program was India's answer to the shortcomings of the FIFA Masters program. So the FIFA Masters program essentially takes a very academic route. And the academic route is not just with one university, but with three universities. So if you look at IISM or NASM, that's why they have options. All these institutes have options for people to decide, I don't want to do an academic course. I would like to do a practical course or a vocational education course. So that's what it is. AIFF Masters is a vocation education training program by AIFF, which hopefully will be the kind of template for almost all programs which exist in Asia Pacific, because the level of football that we see in our neighboring countries is equally as low as what we're seeing in men's football. And the only way we can escalate that is by making sure that capacity building happens by taking best practices, but steeping them in the Indian ecosystem. Our ecosystem is very different from the European ecosystem. And fortunately for us, the kind of resources that have been marshaled internationally to try, because everyone's looking at India as the next big market. As you can see, China is has its own challenges. People are going, China was the number one market in terms of everything, in terms of going and getting students to travel to do the international programs in US. But India is now the next territory. COVID-19 has been a huge spanner, and I think it's going to change and revolutionize football in many ways. We are lucky to hear from some visionaries and some futurists in football. And I think the success of Bundesliga has been a huge success, the restarting. And I think, so in short, the answer, the question you asked me, Anjali, is that AIFF Masters is just one more program at the pinnacle of different programs that we have in All India Football Federation. If someone is very, very clear in their mind that they would like to devote their life and their career in only football management, it is absolutely sports specific. And that's what we've been doing over the last 4 years with West India Football Association, that try and make it sports specific, because there are instances where someone loves cricket, but he doesn't want to go to a swimming pool or doesn't want to go to a badminton court to learn something. I'm a firm believer in cross-pollination of information, because every learning can be utilized somewhere. But the problem with these youngsters is that they have their patience is like really, really. And since I'll be hitting 50 in the next 2 years, I can tell you that when I look at these youngsters, they weren't born with our patience temperance. So from that perspective, I think it'll be interesting. I think it's an interesting future.
Thank you, Shell. Vineet, what would you like to add here?
I think Shell mentioned it very rightly when he said that, you know, the percentage of the women participation in sports in general, football in particular, and at the sports management level, that's more at the higher education level, is it gets narrower. As you go up, it's getting narrower. And we've seen that, you know, we take an example just to take a couple of years back, where at the footballing, you know, so we get students from different sporting backgrounds. Somebody is passionate for a particular sport. Somebody's played a particular sport at a particular level. But from 2017 onwards, and especially after the under-17 Boys World Cup, we saw that there was an increase in the trend of people, you know, from footballing background looking at sports management, because up till then there were no football management specific courses there, and you know, higher education overseas was pretty expensive, not affordable as well in many cases. So for them, it was a viable option to choose sports management. And I hope, and I sincerely hope that the FIFA Under 17 Women's World Cup now is going to be an inflection point with the women participation at the higher education level in terms of sports management.
Okay, that's a good point. I would like to ask all of you all one question. What is the percentage of girls to boy ratio in your academies? Vineet, you can answer that first.
Because we have multiple campuses, you know, there are different ratios at different places, especially up north where it's more conservative society, still women are not that open. You know.
Let's talk about Mumbai.
So Mumbai, it's increasing every year. Currently, we are around 25-30% of our ratio of the last intake that we had. And it's increasing every year. Our go-to state, to be honest, is a 50-50. And we have many, you know, mechanisms in place or encouragements in place to get more women participation. But it's taking its time. It's not that women are their families are too open to have something like this. So it's increasing year on year, and we've seen the level of women participation. And also, so sports essentially, in the beginning, you know, it was treated, sports management education, it was treated with students who can't do anything else, so sports kar lete. So that was the attitude, you know, ye to kar lenge, khelte the hum, padhai mein achche nahi hai, to sports management kar lenge. But now every year, the level of intellect amongst the students or the category of students who are academically also very good are getting better and better. And same, we've seen the ratio in terms of women as well.
Excellent. Another question I want to also ask you is, the people who do come in for sports management, are they necessarily from a playing background or generically every background?
Yeah. So I think Amol answered that well. He said there are two categories. One is from the playing background. They might have played a particular sport for any reason. They couldn't continue that sport. Honestly speaking, not many sports are viable as a career, especially for women in India. It's increasing. It's getting better. But still, so that one category is the playing category. And the second is the passionate category. So that passionate category is, it's kind of a mixture. It's almost equal that we see. But the passionate category is, especially who's just been enjoying sports, who's been passionate about it, viewing sports, and now they want to do a career in this, want to understand more, explore more. So it's kind of an equal mix that we have for both these categories.
Okay, Ruben, what is the percentage of girls in your program? And again, what backgrounds do they come from?
Right, so ours is a fairly new program, right? We're just two batches old and we're fairly in our early stages. So like other sports management institutes, our intake for girl participants are also less at this point. However, we've seen that increase. So just to give you a number, basically, in our first batch of 19, we had one girl. And in our second batch of about 30, we have two girls. It's 100, I mean, if you look at it, it's 100% increase. But from a broader picture, I mean, of course, the idea is to have more women participating and studying sports management. The second part of your question, very interestingly, both the candidates right now who are starting with us come from a very sports management background. So just to break it up, one of them is, you know, has interned with FC Pune City. She's the founder of a Borussia Dortmund fans club in Pune. And she got into sports management because she wanted to help German football and look at how Bundesliga and other German clubs can make a statement over here. So India is very Premier League hungry right now. So she wanted to make a difference from a German football sense. So she's also studying her German various levels as well. So her understanding of football comes from there. And the second one is very interesting. Chinmay is her name. She's worked in operations across IPL, ISL, Pro Kabaddi as well. She's been a part of various non-popular sports like fencing and various racket sports as well. So her idea of getting into sports management was she's done so much of work in operations. She now wants to understand how it is that she can get into the federations or get into popularizing non-commercial sports in India, which are two very distinguished candidates. Moving forward for the third cohort, we are already looking at you know, doubling that number for the 2020 batch as well. So I see a steep rise over the next year or so. And like Vineet said as well, the Under-17 Women's World Cup is going to be a tipping point where you'll have a lot more interest for women to get into sports management.
Amit, what is your ratio in IISM since you all have been around pretty longer?
Both the questions that you asked. One is, we initially didn't have too much of women participation. Everybody echoes the same sentiment. But over the last couple of years, we have made sincere efforts. So from a single percentage digit, we have now gone up to double digit percentage. So we close to, right now we would say around 18% of our total student strength on the campus would be women, girl students, which is a considerable number. The second question, do they come from playing sports background? See, we basically, IISM conducts a sports management aptitude test. So we are pretty, we are very firm on the way that we take in our students. We want to ensure that they have a good aptitude. I'm very happy to say that most of the girls students who come in, 90% of them come from a playing background. I have few international players with me, those thing or any other sport as well, fencing, gymnastics, they have represented internationally. 90% of the students who take, girl students who take admission are sports, from the sporting background. And they're very clear in their thought. Others who come in, they come in for their masters, they come from their engineering background, they come from, I actually have students from medical background, which will be surprising to quite a few of the participants out here. So I do have students who have finished their medical background, ensured that they have done what their parents wanted them to do, and then come and now are pursuing their dream with IISM for sports management. So it's a different percentage when it comes to women playing sports. That's 90%, and currently around 18% is what I have on my campus. That's the ratio currently.
Excellent. It's good to hear. I want to ask all of you all again: will you all do something to attract more girls in your coming courses, like have some female-centric marketing campaigns, reach out to some institutes where, it's girl-centric, or possibly offer a scholarship or a reduction in fees for girls just to encourage them to get more involved with the sports management courses? Amit, you can answer that.
Yeah, well, yes, we do have different campaigns, but I personally feel more than a campaign, what attracts more students, or what the reason that we have seen rise in the student is the current students itself. See, what happens is let's give you an example. I got one student from Northeast. Now, looking at her, I had more students. I don't need to market. Marketing is, everybody understands what is marketing. Succeed in the industry when they go and they get into the Kabaddi League, or they're getting into the IPL or the ISL, others tend to follow them. I don't think so. Anything better than this to attract more. They need to have examples amongst themselves itself. See, rather than looking up, the industry at women who are already established, they would like to look at their fellow students and understand, okay, I can get into this. For example, we had quite a few of, when we were the official knowledge partners for Khelo India Youth Games as well as University Games. The whole contingent of the team which went and worked before the game started was led by female students. Now, because of this, I know that the girl students at our institute know what has to be done. They know that there is something out there for them. It's not only a man's world. Even we can go and prove ourselves out there. So it is better to prove, these girls to prove, which will attract more students. That's what I personally feel. Doing seminars and marketing campaigns is something that everybody does.
Okay. Amol, do you all do anything differently to encourage more female participation?
So I think Shell did mention about the gender disparity when it comes to sports, which is rightly so our observation as well for the last 5 years. Our female to male ratio has always fluctuated between 10 to 15%. We are yet to figure out, why is that fluctuation? But yeah, it fluctuates between 10 to 15%. And you know, when I look at the process of someone taking an admission in a sports management institute, so I'm comparing how a boy or a man, you know, how does a guy take an admission vis-a-vis, you know, what is the process for a female to take admission in sports management institute. When it's a boy who wants to do sports management, his parents are convinced that he's taking the right decision. They back him up. In fact, the father goes on to say, I have not been able to fulfill my dream of playing sport. Here is a chance, you take it up. He backs him up to the hilt. But when it comes to the women, the girls, you know, they are always accompanied by the parents. The parents always have a lot of apprehensions about, is it the right thing to do? Is it the mainstream? What would she do? Does it mean that she has to work for long hours? Does she have to travel? And you know, there are a lot of questions. In fact, some parents want to say that she's going to get married in a couple of years. Does she really have to do this? So these are the questions that, you know, a parent has about their own daughters. We try and address it, you know, in different ways. We do it through counseling. And as Amit also rightly pointed out that, you know, the marketing is probably one tool, but once they are in the Sports Management Institute, the counseling plays a very big role. And even a bigger role is played by word of mouth or by success stories. So every year, by the way, we have had, you know, girl students, and all of them, I mean, quite a few of them have been CAs. So I think Amit spoke about girls coming from medical background. In our case, we see a lot of girls coming from CA background. And, you know, we tell them about the previous success stories. So we ask them and encourage them, okay, here are the students, list of students that we have. You can talk to them, get a first-hand experience of, you know, of their experience. And then you can make an informed decision, because there are a lot of apprehensions, and it's important to not push them into any decision, but let that be a collective decision. Because when a girl takes an admission, it's a family decision. When it's a boy who takes a decision, it's only an individual, I want to do it and I'm going to do it. So that disparity, I see it even now, even 5 years now. Of course, the number of women students, you know, those are slightly picking up. And I see a trend. I mean, I could see a spike coming very soon. But, you know, even after the numbers going up, the number of students who, or the number of women students who actually go on to take an admission has to, you know, it can be still better. It can be improvised. And I think it's good that, it's a very good question that you asked, because I think it's something for us as a Sports Management Institute to also think about different ways as to how do we address each of those concerns, and how do we try and encourage more and more women participation. So far we have been successful primarily because of our previous case studies. We asked them to talk to our students. I mean, from the first batch, I think in the first batch we had this girl who's right now working with Puneri Paltan. Every year we have got girls who are, you know, and they're successful and they're working really well in the respective sports companies. So once they talk to them, I think they are convinced that this is the right choice for me. So that's how we address it at different levels.
Okay. Shell, my next question is to you, because the AIFF Masters is a football-related course, and I am trying to increase in female participation in football. What are you consciously going to do to get more female managers who could eventually be role models? You know, I mean, we've seen so many EPL or Champions League games where you see the woman who's got her mic on and she's just controlling the entire match and the entire match operations. And it's so inspirational to see that, you know, one woman and she's just doing such a fantastic job of it. When will we see that in India?
When I start with the last question here, when will we see that in India? Actually, I don't have the answer. I hope it's in my lifetime. I know I'm being pretty pessimistic right now, but India is a land of deep-rooted cultural sensitivities. So a place where if the head is covered, chances of you playing football with your legs uncovered are pretty remote. Okay, so that is one. Secondly, I would say you hit the nail on the head when you said that, what are we doing differently for women? We're not doing anything differently. Why should we do something differently? Because the minute you start doing things differently, you're trying to put them as a special interest category, as if like they have some kind of a problem. Why can we not have universal schemes or universal ideas? So let me come back to that one point first. marketing. In marketing jargon, you always have a target audience. And then target audience is demographically broken up as per gender, as per age, as per income group, etc. So if any educational institution over here wishes to reach out to girls, they will be targeting the youth. I don't think anyone's going to create a campaign which is very women focused or women centric, because, and this is the most important part, because these youngsters are joining this program because they want a transformation at the end of it. They need a job. They need to earn money. They want something which empowers them. So when they started, they were engaging with us. When they were with us, there was a value proposition that we gave as educators, as teachers to them. And at the end of that particular period with us, they have to have a tangible transformation. Now, why this is so stark is because if you go to do your BCom, BSc or BA, you don't go back to the college and say, hey, you didn't give me a job. But here in sports management, which is in some ways pretty unfair, and I think it's also largely led by the aspirations and expectations. It's like the minute someone doesn't get a job, they go to social media and they start venting their ire, or they get upset and they say, I spent so much money in this program and I haven't got a job. So I think the answer lies whether you are a boy or a girl. It is universal. And that is this, that looking at the economy today and even preceding the COVID-19, the empowerment of these youngsters has to be towards entrepreneurship. They have to be more entrepreneurial, because there are no jobs. There is no job security, so-called very, very, in fact, over the last several years, everything has been project focused. Everything is a project. The minute that project gets over, you move to another project, even though you're in the same company, same designation, doesn't matter. So to specifically answer your question, Anjali, is that AIFF has multiple programs, and all those programs are for all Indians. Everybody is accessible. We have free programs. We have programs which are at a token fee of probably few hundred rupees. And then you have the AIFF Masters program, which is expensive because you've got to take these boys and girls all the way to Spain, take care of their accommodation, take care of their meals, take care of their ground transportation, take care of their training in different verticals, get them to stay over there. Now, of course, a major chunk is ensuring that they come back safely. So a huge amount of medical and insurance exposure. So I would say that on AIFF side, I don't think, especially with the AIFF Masters, we will be differentiating or creating any distinction for this. And also lastly, there are two ways to approach something. And that is either you go full measure or you don't go at all. So the full measure is, let's assume that any of the institutions on this call do a 30% discount for girls. Why shouldn't a boy get that discount? Like, what is the parameter? There has to be some logic behind it. Just because this person is a girl, but she could be economically well off. She could be coming from a better family, better educated background. So why should someone get that discount? Because it is demeaning to the girls. Because if you're starting somebody by telling them that you have some inadequacy, which I'm fulfilling by giving you this discount, you are eroding their self-worth. And that's the worst way you can start education for anybody.
Okay, Shel, point well taken over there. I want to continue with you with another question is, how do you, like you said, everyone needs to get a job when they end this course, yeah? There probably aren't so many jobs now. How do you light or ignite the fire through your course for an individual to become an entrepreneur in sports?
Okay, so a very good question, Anjali. The thing is that almost everybody should get some exposure in a company, in a system, because that's where you learn the processes and systems. Now, many of the institutes on this call are replicating it during the program. So when they bring an external industry expert, that person comes and takes them through by showing real life examples of how their organization works, how they actually are going to be getting that when they pass out from this program and join the industry. But what is changing, and changing extremely fast, is the dynamic nature of the working profile. Even before COVID-19, if you see, the stock market does not reflect the ground realities of the inflation or the GDP. These are disparities when it comes to the ground reality. So let's take the example of somebody who runs a sports management company. or a sports marketing company, and this person's job is to go to a school and take their after-school programs. Now, these constitute a lot. Many of the pass-outs from these institutes are being hired by them, and then these students become the interface. But that particular student does not want to do that because the sports is a highly individualistic choice. So if I say that when I'm joining this program because I want to be a football manager and I want to be active on the field of play, but in all likelihood, the example that you mentioned, that it was nice to see this one wonderful example of a manager doing a dynamic job. The reason why it stands out is because if you look at Europe, there are hardly any female managers making their mark in that sense. So there is a disparity in terms of the top positions available for girls, no doubt in my mind. And the only way that I'm absolutely certain it will be broken is because the girls exercise the choice. Because there are different ways of learning. So learning starts, just to quickly give you a 101 on this thing, that so you have individual and you have collective. You have hierarchical and you have distributed. So the way this works is that if you are looking at the existing model of our schooling culture, it's hierarchical, which means you have to study from this teacher, what paper they set, you have to answer the question like that, that's when you'll get the marks. But the world has moved to a distributed way of working, which means I may have one skill set, Vineet may have another skill set, Ruben may have third skill set, and we have to collaborate to make it work. And this is the biggest advantage that girls are going to have in this decade, because for the first time ever, they're going to be literally at level playing field. So to sum up the question that you asked me, is that what I see which needs to be done is that, number one, let girls exercise their choice more clearly in the beginning of the program. The institutions are already giving them exposure during the program and giving them a reality check, because almost everybody who joins a program has a very different picture of what sports manager is. And when they come and realize, but why do you want me to lift a bottle of water? Why do you want me to go and do this, you know, put the tables together? So, and almost many of them come thinking that implementation, sports implementation is the wow thing. That's how the event management industry became big. But by the time the program gets over, they realize that implementation is the worst kind of job to do, because the chances of earning better revenue, better income, better salary, and climbing up the corporate ladder is weaker in implementation. It's higher when you are looking after intellectual property, when you're creating. So my advice to all the girls on this call especially would be, is step number one, be very clear, why do you want to be in sports? Because sports is never going to make you the kind of money which many other fields will do. Number two, if you just are passionate about sports, because we're all in this field because the minute we smell that grass on the ground, if something happens to us, if that's what you are and you want to be close to sports, remember that you will not always be on the ground. In fact, nobody's on the ground right now. You may have to do work which is data analytics, nothing to do with the ground. Thirdly, sports is moving more towards data-driven aspects. So today, more people are making money through data in sports than they're making by working actually in the sports on the field jobs. So that is the answer, Anjali. I don't know if that clarifies exactly what you're looking for.
It did clarify to a large extent. Amit, what are your views? How do you ignite the passion to make a student an entrepreneur?
Well, to begin with, we, as I mentioned earlier, we have our own entrepreneurship development cell. So our associate dean works very closely. Yes, they get exposed to what happens in the industry first, not right from the day one they are driven into that, but they get exposed to what happens in the industry. They are asked to present their case studies, and I'm very happy to state that yes, we do have our girl students who are a part of our entrepreneurship cell, and they have come up with fantastic projects. Now they are been taken forward by our team, and let's see how it goes ahead.
Okay, Amol.
So my view is that entrepreneurship is not for everyone. There are a lot of challenges, and it's for those thick-skinned, someone who's very determined, someone who has the expertise, knowledge, and is very committed. Without all these skills and the experience in place, if anyone, be it a woman or a guy, if they were to start something of their own, the chances of them being success are slim. I'm not saying they won't be successful. Of course, there are exceptions for everything. But I think it's better if a student works at different places. Even if it means job hopping or doing multiple projects, I'm still okay with it because it gives them exposure to different cultures. It gives them exposure to different companies, how they function, their challenges, and you know how they succeed. When they take all these learnings with them, probably it could mean a year for someone. It could mean 2 years or less or more than, you know, depending on everyone's capabilities and you know their experience. Only then they should decide whether they want to start something of their own. Because I have seen students who have immediately started off something of their own and they have struggled. And if I were to encourage as a sports management institute for everyone to take entrepreneurship, I think that wouldn't be right on my part, because there are those challenges which they are not yet aware of. It could also mean accounts, finances, GST, registration. All of this is a different animal. It's a different breed altogether. And I don't think that they are yet ready. I mean, we can give them the theory, the education to make them success out of it. But still, I would have my apprehensions and I would encourage them to get into sports companies, get exposure, learn from it, and then you take on something like a cool word as entrepreneurship.
Okay. Ruben, do you share that view or do you have a different opinion?
So, to start off with, the kind of job opportunities when you look at after you complete the program here, the biggest advantage that we have is we're actually a full-fledged sports management agency, which is on track, right? So year on year, we're looking at least 20 to 25% of our batch taking up positions within the various verticals that India on Track has across the country, which is grassroots development, consultancy and strategy, digital marketing, and even sports education now. Even GISB, we started off with a lean team, but as we grow over the next few years, God bless, we'll be able to, you know, hire more students from the program within our own company. So that in itself creates a very unique offering for that matter. We have a very strong network of industry affiliates and partners because we are from the industry. I saw your video. You had Peter from the IGCC. We've actually partnered with the IGCC. So the girl that I spoke about earlier, Tejaswini, since she's so connected to Dortmund, she actually has been working with Peter on various sports initiatives that the IGCC has been doing with Peter, with Jonas, with Sebastian, with all of them. So we look at where the gaps need to be filled, and we then look at having us creating and curating positions for our students within these companies. I also come back to the interesting point which I made earlier, saying that the faculty are professionals, right? So when you get the opportunity to network or, you know, spend one-on-one time with a particular professional, they also understand that, hey, this is the person that I could probably get in once they are done with the program. So that also creates a very unique opportunity for our students. But that is from the job sense. Now, because we are, from a sports industry perspective, we are so early in our growth phase, obviously there are not too many big companies to work for at this phase. So you will have a good number of entrepreneurs, so to say. So even if two students come together and set up an event agency, they are in a sense an entrepreneur, right? They are doing corporate events, they are doing grassroots development, which is something that at this phase, all small pieces of the puzzle need to come together to ensure that the entire industry sort of grows. So from our side, what we've done is we've sort of engaged them with sessions with, so just to share, our program director Neil Shah is on the panel for Qatar Sports Tech and Tokyo Sports Tech. So he tries to bring in a lot of international exposure in sports tech and entrepreneurship there. We have a few sports accelerator programs in Bombay itself. The Marwa Group is one of them. So we work closely with them where, you know, the head of sports comes and spends at least 4 to 6 hours with our students, sharing them about at least the theoretical structure of what an entrepreneur should perform and how, you know, what is the go-to-market strategy or how you should come up with your business plan, how you should approach investors, etc. The idea is, even when you are, see, ownership is very important. Even when you are working in a company, an entrepreneur always has a sense of ownership. You take ownership in a particular role when you get in there, right? I've also been an entrepreneur, so I completely understand what it takes to, you know, have students sort of build that repertoire. So I guess how it's going to shape up is only time will tell. But from our side, as sports management institutes, we should give the students and the aspiring professionals all the theory and all the ammo, so to say, so that they can sort of excel in whatever they take on in the next few years.
Okay, Vinit, lastly, what is your opinion on this, entrepreneurship versus getting into a professional job?
Yes. So I think, like Amol mentioned, that and entrepreneurship is not for everybody. It's to each its own types. What we do over the course, over the period of the whole course. So like we try and facilitate students to different internship opportunities. I think most of the educational institutes here over would be doing that as well. So that just gives not just a chance, you know, to work on different roles for a student, but it also gives. So if in 25 internship opportunities in a year, he's doing the course for 2 or 3 years, depending on the course that he's in, he's getting an exposure to 50 or 40 different small roles. And that serves a possibility for him to network, you know. So networking these days is a very big thing. So network is your net worth, like we like to say. And especially for entrepreneurs, before they plunge into entrepreneurship, having a working at a few years at a particular company, building a certain sense of network, because especially in the sports industry, networking is your network. So we suggest that to students. Apart from that, as a entrepreneurship experience, we also have an in-house program. We call it the Yuva Premier League. It's a multi-sport, multi-college program, which last year there were more than 70 colleges which participated, more than 1,000 students, where students curate the whole program from planning to looking out for sponsorship to actual execution. So it gives them the experience of the whole journey. It's not just one part that they're working to. We kind of, you know, give the liberty to the students where they're having the whole opportunity to see from conceptualization to actual execution and also after sales. So in this case, you know, it gives them an opportunity to feel what an entrepreneurship experience is like. So like I said, it tweaks its own, and it's not for everyone. We can't hear you.
Vinit, thank you so much. You've just taken my net worth to $1 billion. Network is your net worth. I'm so excited to hear that. I think I'm $1 billion plus, because if what you're saying is right. Okay, we're going to get Bela on. Bela, can we have a few words from you?
Yeah. So, interesting take from everybody on entrepreneurship and what all students can do. Like Shail mentioned, right? I've been an entrepreneur, have been in related.
Bela, can I please request you to put your video on? We sure. Want to see you.
Yes. Sorry about that. Yes.
Don't worry.
Yeah. So like Shail was saying, being an entrepreneur for a very long time, come from a professional background, etc. What I would like to add here is that all of us, all the institutes here, and everybody tries to give in their best to the students in terms of engagement, getting industry faculty and exposure, whether it is working on internal events, whether it's working on live event experiences and everything. The challenge, I think, in this is what we have experienced across is the student, once they're exposed to internships and work environments with different companies, they're young and they're like a sponge, right? So they absorb different things and the takeaways are very, very different. So at the end of any course, it is very easy to encourage a student to go for entrepreneurship. But do they know enough? Okay. Do they know enough about the opportunities, different opportunities within a certain stream? For example, when you talk even about football, right? Within football, from what Shell is doing, what the associations are doing and other companies of the leagues are doing, there is a vast difference. Now, where is the opportunity for the student? It takes everybody a while to sort of understand what they want to do. Okay? And again, like what Shail had mentioned, is the younger generation, the patience levels are very less, right? So it is very easy for them to get discouraged. Okay? So they need to mature like a good wine in the process, see what they actually want to do. And just beyond just hearing a professional talk about cash flow, business plan, etc., understand whether they're ready. Because when you start an entrepreneurship, you take responsibility of the entire team, financially and otherwise also. Are they ready for something like that? So our encouragement is, yes, to give them all the possible exposure, but at the same time, nurture and guide them towards what could be possible for them in the best course of action. Exactly like Amol said, just because you have a passion for it and you want to jump into it, does not mean you jump into it now. Take your time, understand, is my takeaway. So while we all try our best, I would encourage students to first take a call, work with organizations, understand before they take the entrepreneurship. Thank you.
Thank you, Bela. That makes absolute sense. It's better for you to learn from the experience of others than to do it yourself and learn the hard way.
Absolutely. And then things like this happen, right? Nobody expected a COVID. So
Absolutely.
The largest of companies is now letting go of people. So
Absolutely. Bela, thank you so much. Bela's going to be leaving us because she has another engagement. Bela, thank you very much. I am going to be in touch with you very soon.
Thank you, Anjali, and thank you, everyone. Interesting discussion. Good luck.
Thank you, Bela. Thank you. My next question actually is related to COVID and Corona and how. What is your take on how everyone should, in the sports industry, should cope with it? Amit, first to you. Please unmute.
This is one situation which, can you hear me?
Yeah, perfect.
Okay, now this is one situation which is totally unexpected to everybody out here, by us, to everybody. But yes, it has affected the sporting industry like nobody else. And looks like sporting industry along with the education industry will be the last ones to kind of back into action. But saying this, yes, once it opens up, COVID is here to stay. I'm making a statement. This is my own views. COVID is here to stay. You can't definitely eradicate it. So people will live with it. And I think by November, December, the sports should be back in action. In India, I hope it should be back in action with the national games. Because if you're talking about Olympics happening in 2021, then national games should definitely be happening towards end of the year, and that should pave part for the thing. In the meanwhile, your esports is doing extremely good. I see a lot of my students who are not into esports getting into esports, whether it is getting involved in playing of esports on a very professional level, or whether it is involved into marketing, or whether it is involved into operations. So as of now, I can say yes, it's esports. When we are back in action, I think they announced the India tour to Australia also in December 2020. So I think by that time we should be very well back in action.
Amol, what is your opinion on how to deal with the current situation?
I wish I had a crystal ball and I could tell what's going to roll out in the future. We can only speculate about it. We do not know what's going to happen. The world leaders are struggling to find an answer. So I'm just a nobody to give out any kind of statement out here. But what can be done till the time we recover is not just as a business, as an institute, and as an individual. We can all invest time in upskilling, learning new skills, whatever passions that you have. So, for example, we are encouraging our students to get into graphic designing, get into different softwares, learn few apps, maybe video editing, because these are all the skills which are going to help them, once they start off in the sports industry. Because when they start off in the sports industry, they are asked to do multiple things. And with my experience, I've seen that they are asked to, it could be as simple as writing an email, for example. It could be emails, it could be communication, it could be graphic designing. So as an individual, as a business, I think it's the right time for us to introspect. It's the right time for us to learn new skills and hope and pray that things change much sooner. And then things are back in action and they're ready for it. Sorry, you'll have to unmute, Anjali.
Ruben, what are you all doing as an institute to keep your students engaged during this time?
Right, so two parts, right? One is from the sports industry perspective and one is from the sports management students perspective. So with regards to the program, we are running into the last 2 months of our program as planned. And even before COVID hit us, we were sort of prepared. We had a lot of sessions happening over video, so to say. So we've conducted our classes online. We had a lot of projects happening with students. And the course has moved completely. We've completely adapted and moved online, the program online. With regards to the industry in general, I think the entire industry is just taking a step back and going back to the drawing board and just taking a call on how they actually want to move forward, right? It's only a matter of time until which this industry is going to open. And we all are figuring out what is the new normal now. But what I see is that inherently companies that are digital first are the ones that are doing really well. So whether it is media companies, you know, SportsKeeda, Bridge, other content companies that are coming out there, video companies as well. You have a lot of data companies that are now looking to get back in action with live sport coming back without crowds as well. Grassroots is a space which is going to suffer for some time until schools and public gatherings are allowed. However, esports, I'll echo Amit as well. Esports is an industry that has grown tremendously well from that time. How we are sort of having our students, empowering our students at this point is trying to help them look at, personal development through blogs, through writing, through, podcasts. I'm sure our students have sort of reached out to a lot of people in the industry right now. Every second day, we are seeing a new blog on esports and an interview with someone from football. Also, what it's made us realize is that the growth at which the sports industry was growing, it was going at a particular speed. What I feel is that once we get back from COVID, I think the growth is only going to be faster because we'll come out much stronger and much better. Apart from IPL, I think all the other industries weren't gaining as much. You don't have that much of crowd coming into the PKL or ISL. For that matter, IPL has the big bucks and the big commercial gain. So they are the ones who are suffering the most. But the others can just wait it out till the end of the year and then sort of start acting on the new normal, so to say.
Vineet, are you all currently engaging with your students? And if yes, what are you all doing?
So because we are mandated to follow certain criteria, so we are on with the online session. Probably by June 15, we would be done with, last year we'd be completing that. Exams is another story altogether, especially the Mumbai batch, how they're going to be doing that. But irrespective, we are encouraging students like to upskill themselves, to learn different skills. We've given a lot of projects which students are engaged in. This is a good time to go back to research. We are encouraging students to do a lot of research on their particular projects, on their particular, interests that they have. And apart from that, we're encouraging students. So this, it's a saying like tough times don't last, tough people do. We're encouraging our students to just stick on because we are sure. And like Ruben said, we are hopeful that it's going to be a V-shaped recovery, especially in sports. And with a football fan myself, I've never watched a Bundesliga before. And this is the first time I was watching live Bundesliga. So all of us, waiting for sports, live sports to come, be it IPL, EPL or other sports. And we hope everything goes back to normal as soon as possible.
Yeah, the Bundesliga has really made a very smart move over there in gaining markets.
Yes.
Amol, what's your view on currently coping with the COVID situation?
Anjali, I've already addressed that question what we are doing here.
Shell, since you're going to be starting your course pretty much during the COVID session, how are you all going to deal with it?
Okay. So I'll first tell you about the specific program at AIFF Masters. It's the inaugural batch. So we are more or less done with our admission cycle for this year. As I mentioned, that this is the top end of the program that we had. There's no other program as expensive as this one that we have. And I think the football aficionados were waiting for a program like this. So we're done with our admissions. In fact, literally tomorrow is the final date for that. And I think the market is going to change in such a way that the low-end jobs are going to be completely, they're already decimated, but very few will come back because many of the low-end jobs are being replaced by automated third-party software. So all those students who are passing out from the institutes now will have to upgrade their skill sets with the assistant of the institutes to try and see how can they go for the mid-level and high-level positions, because that's how it's going to be. You need to be multi-skilled, and you need to. So programs which are already providing this. So ultimately, it's a question of what kind of program you go. So if you take up a part-time program and you're juggling this with a job of yours, obviously you're not devoting that much time. But whereas those who are doing a master's level program and they're devoting a lot of time, those ones will be in a better position to use that ecosystem, that network that they have actually created. So I think the first guideline or the first red flag that I can share with all the boys and girls on this call, and especially the girls, because this is a football forum and it's a girls football forum. So the first thing is that girls football is harder than boys football. I mean, whether someone agrees or doesn't agree, that's the reality. I'm talking about globally. Okay, globally, women's football is will hurt and will take longer to come back than men's football. Secondly, private clubs are going to see sponsorship flee. So sponsorship is going to, coming back to Anjali, is one of those rare breeds who puts her own money into her business because that's her passion. Many clubs out there are going to depend upon revenue coming in from sponsorships. And in that aspect, if there is no sponsorship, girls are not going to get paid. Girls are not going to get positioned. So all I'm saying is that try and think about, if there was no one to look out for you, what would you do to ensure or carve out your position in the field? Because in the next few months, 50% of those guys who had a job in sports will not have a job, even though they exist right now. And lastly, those who have created or started something of their own are the ones who are more likely to learn and have the highest, steepest learning curve. So many of my fellow panelists have expressed this opinion that entrepreneurship is tough. For sure it is tough because you're learning and you have to learn so many things by yourself with you taking the initiative and very quickly. So the best way to learn something is to make a mistake and do that. So my advice, again, I'm repeating this again, that if you are at the mercy of someone else, your job or your position will be hacked, most likely. But you will not fire yourself as long as you can have a couple of sponsors or revenue streams or any kind of pivot that you do. So that's what it is, Anjali. As far as AIFF Masters goes, we've been fortunate because we are at the very high end of the spectrum. And so that's where it is.
Thanks, Shell. I know it is going to be very tough for the women's game, even tougher than it was before, which is why I am doing what I am doing. I am gathering all stakeholders, players, coaches, administrators, managers, people involved in the sports management business. And I'm going to create a common platform where each can leverage from the other. So that's going to be my goal. And I'm going to talk to all of you all offline about that. We're going to be starting taking some questions now. We'll start off with Adarsh Singh. Adarsh, please introduce yourself and tell me who you want your question addressed to. Accordingly, the person will answer.
Sure. Thanks, Anjali. Hi, everyone. I'm Adarsh and currently a student at GISB. I'm also running a podcast on Indian football. That focuses on various aspects of Indian football, including grassroots. And I've had few guests from ISL clubs as well as grassroots academies. And this Sunday, I'll be having Lucian Boyan on my podcast. So my question basically is that a lot of discussion went on about in this webinar where the panelists said that everybody used to do foreign education in terms of sports and then come back to India and start working here, or maybe get into industry and learn the skill and then get better at what they're doing. But now, with more and more aspiring sports professionals considering these sports management programs, do you all also see the stakeholders in clubs, franchises and federations be more willing to hire these aspiring professionals, the ones who are doing the courses in India itself?
Is this directed towards any particular panelist or just anybody?
Anybody can take it.
Who would like to take this? Vineet, would you answer this?
Good question, Adarsh. I guess what you've rightly, you know, asked for is, would the stakeholders, as in the various companies, federation, would they be looking for people from these backgrounds, the sports management background? And I'll share a live example of my example itself. I'm a chartered accountant by qualification. It's just my passion for sports or with regards to education that I've come into this field. Earlier during our times, and especially, you know, foreign education was not viable in terms of if you're thinking of coming back to India, spending an X amount, you're not going to even cover the interest cost once you land a job over here back in India. So that was pretty difficult or could be afforded by only particular set of students or whose parents, like, you know, who parents were like Anjali, who were pretty encouraging their students, their children, that, okay, follow your passion. money will come later on. That's not a problem in that case. But, you know, for all the other companies, they were looking for people. And earlier, there were not many options available for them. And many of the companies that are hiring at our colleges, they are the first thing that they tell us that earlier we used to have people from engineering background, people from accounting background, from different backgrounds. Now they know where to look at. You know, people who are passionate in sports, and especially, you know, industry like sports is something which is not for everyone. It's not for somebody, because there is a lot of legwork, a lot of hard work required, a lot of passion required to be determined, because it's not the easy way out. And therefore, what I feel and what we've seen with, you know, companies, prospective companies or federation, they are looking for other people who are passionate in sports, who have worked earlier in sports, and that's their ideal candidate, rather than hiring somebody from an engineering background and they're not sure if the passion or the, you know, interest in sports is there. So I am sure that more and more companies, so more and more stakeholders are going to look out for, and I'm sure all the, you know, different educational institutes that are there over here, they'll agree with me when we are having a lot of inquiries from different places, even small clubs. Sports club, forget the big ones, the ISL clubs or federation, they are the big ones. They are obviously hiring. But even small places, you know, there is a company in Andheri, Mumbai, which has 400 sports video analysts. So that is the kind of demand. So where are they going to look for people? They're going to look for people who are interested in sports, and they're going to look for people at our kind of institutes, you know, where they would find ideal candidates. Anjali, we can't hear you.
Yeah, Anjali, does that answer your question?
Can I also answer this question?
Please do.
Yeah, Adarsh, basically what happens is, I would like to use the word, see, when you're doing a course abroad, yes, they are fantastic. I'm nobody to comment about them. But at the same time, when you're working in India, you need a, what I call it, as an Indianized education approach. So if you have let's say that what we have in our case, when you have students who are sports person, who have, you know, who have played sport in India, they take sports management, you know, they do their sports management. It's easy for the federation. I have somebody from, I have an archer with me who was a national level archer with me. That lady, the girl does her sports management, and tomorrow if the Archery Federation wants to pick up somebody, she would be the right choice, because she knows how the things work in India, how the game happens here. You know, it is a case across. I'm saying, if you want to study abroad, my take is, study abroad, please work abroad. When you come back in India, as rightly Vinit said, the return of investment will not match. That's a different thing altogether. But that's the reason why the federations, I'm sticking only to the federations, why the federations would prefer to hire you.
Anjali, I would also like to address it. Yeah. So Adarsh, I'll just give you my own example. You know, I've done my MBA in marketing from New Zealand. I was there for almost 3 years. I came back to India and, you know, I started looking for jobs. Then I realized that my friends from the same year, they have already progressed a lot. In their own careers, because they were able to invest that time networking with the right people. As Vinith rightly said, your network is your net worth. So if you are planning to do or study abroad, then it's better if you have the opportunity, it's better to find a job out there in that country itself. If you're planning to come back to India, you might as well invest that time in India itself, networking with a lot of companies. And this is true with associations. This is true with any private sports company, because if you know people, the job gets done in India. As simple as that.
Adarsh, does that answer your question?
Yeah, totally. Thank you.
Okay, our next question is from Livana. Livana. Yeah, Livana, go ahead.
Thank you, ma'am. Hi, guys. My name is Livana, and it's not exactly a question. It's more like a build on. This previous question and all the answers that came from it kind of set the tone as to what I'm going to say further. So I'm building on Shail's point, but I think before that, a little about my personal background. So I have 2 masters in sports management from 2 different continents, and the reason for that being that I want to experience and gain a lot more in terms of practical knowledge as to how their ecosystems work. One being Oceania, and the country I was in was New Zealand. I worked with the FIFA Under 20 World Cup there with competitions, with operations right there in their tunnel. The other one is France. I studied in France, knowing French. And then I worked with Adidas at their headquarters in their football football marketing department, which is so involved with product creation. It is the creation process that you're a part of. So I'm building on Shell's point as to what he said at 4:30. It is for the progress that these courses and these programs are bringing to the country with their aspiring students and the new waves of professionals that are soon going to be plunging into the market. I say this from a personal experience, and I have a reason for saying it, is that I think some of these programs, or rather maybe this is something that everyone can take back, I guess, is that especially now in COVID-19, and this webinar is based on women's football and COVID-19, is that a lot of professions out there, especially the ones who are studying right now and then getting the job market, and having been in the global system myself, there is so much soft skill missing. There is command of the language missing, systemic thinking, analytical and critical thinking. I personally believe that, yes, having a passion and having a playing background gives you a foot in the door, but it is not the end all and the be all of a professional. You have got to push the end here. You have got to tell the students that if they're looking not at just an Indian setting, but beyond that, because you're talking about foreign investors now coming to the country, before, unlike any time before in the history of sports here, you're going to be mixing with FIFA officials, players, there's not enough emphasis in learning a different language. We're talking about TLOs, like team liaison officers, if you're looking at working within the FIFA World Cup serving India. How are we going to move ahead? Okay, even if not foreign languages, but maybe even regional languages, you know, take it further, take another step further. I've jotted down a couple of notes here. And the other one being, also to add on to that, is that when you're at university abroad, when you're liaising with other stakeholders abroad in your company or working at in your federations, you get put into the pool based on your culture. Oh, she's Indian, she's a woman working in sports, they're brown skin, what do they know? This happens out there. And even though you might be better than your peers, you have really got to work a lot more harder to prove yourself out there. It's not needed, but it happens. And this brings me back to the question of women-centric marketing in educational institutions of sports right now in India. I feel that, yes, it doesn't, women special interest group here, but I feel that giving subsidies in education really minimizes the marginalized sect that we already are. Like Amol said, girls' decisions, it's a family decision. And yes, maybe not in urban backgrounds as much, but people for whom money is, you've got to think twice, it is a family decision. So I believe that subsidies is giving them a head start with already a male-dominant industry. I really feel it will make a difference. And if you're looking at equity, let them show that in their work in the industry. Besides that, success stories, women-centric marketing, I think can make a difference. And I think that's about it.
Well said, Livana. Well said. I couldn't have expected less from you. So, you know, I feel so privileged. These are the girls I have worked with, from them being very, very young. And to see all of them take on such fantastic roles and become leaders makes me feel fantastic. Guys, I hope you all heard Livana and what her take was, because she has excellent experience. And besides that, she's also a football player. Livana, you forgot to say that.
My passion has been, I started playing at 5, but I think I took that. And like most of us here, like, we don't know what our backgrounds would lead us to. I thought, yeah, let's make some good money. So my bachelor's are in banking and finance from here, but I couldn't do it anymore. But you know, that works as a lens when you take things further. It helps you with financial management in university. And I think that a lot of my classes were practical based, were outside the classroom. We had to go to clubs. We went to Marseille FC, LOM, that's Olympic Marseille in France, presented to their board of directors at Adidas, just speaking directly to open door policies to directors of various departments, and you know how the entire system works, talent management, asset management, dealing with athletes directly who are now on the global front. When you're working at the World Cup, you don't know how many people you come across who are going to take your head. FIFA commissioners, coaches, players. And I really think that if, besides theoretical and technical knowledge in classrooms, the program to a step further and make it practically oriented, could serve us in good stead.
Thank you, Levana.
Anjali, I would like to add to what Levana just addressed, because sure. I was also in the same country as she was. I mean, I was also in New Zealand, and I think probably that's the most beautiful country, the least racist country in the world. But if one is going to go overseas to do sports management, and inevitably the preference is given to the natives, whether you like it or not. That's the hard fact of it. I know quite a few of my friends, even some of my students, who had done their sports management in European countries. They have done it from Germany, from Scotland. They have spent a lot of money out there and they have come back to India. So I completely understand where Levana is coming from, that someone has to really look at the decision as to the why part of it before they actually invest their money, time and effort in a broader overseas education. And regarding the second part of it, I would take this opportunity, because Levana had a very different point to what Shail had mentioned about, if we give discounts or scholarships to women, how would they look at it? So Anjali, I would like you to do research about it. If Sports Management Institute were to offer any discounts to women, how would they perceive it? Would they take it positively, or they would be neutral to it? If you could do some research, I think that would help us and our other panelists. So, course correct our direction.
I will definitely do this research, and I will definitely share it with all of you all.
I'd just like to add to Levana's point, right? So, beyond education, if you look at the way we've curated our program, it is coming from a place where a lot of times you have to make that elevator pitch, or you have those 2 minutes with someone senior in the industry. A lot of times we have some ideas, but seldomly are able to execute or share those ideas very confidently, right? So what we've done is, before you even start a first sports subject or sports module in our program at GISB, you actually go through a 2-month foundation period, which is soft skill development, where you do communication skills, organizational behavior, neuro-linguistic programming, decision-making, basically channelizing your interest, your mind towards what it is that is your purpose in life, right? This is all beyond what theoretical studies or even what sports management teaches. This is just for you to become a better human being so that you are happy and fulfilled in whatever you do. So we spend about 2 months in that, and we've seen, Adarsh is not here, but maybe you would have shared here, but we've seen that this has helped a lot of our students, really massively, because the sports industry is very hard. It's going to punch you down. When you're out there in meetings, 9 out of 10 times you're going to get beaten down to pulp, right? But it is in the end your attitude that is going to get you up there. So I think Levana, you hit the nail on the head when you speak about, looking at soft skill development as priority. With regards to the other piece of discussion, this question didn't come up to me. So, just to share, our management has actually put out a notice saying that we are happy to provide exclusive scholarships to women up to 50% for women, to promote women in sport. Because at this point, it is the interest is not there, and we should encourage, whether they are from backward communities or affluent communities. It is a mandate that our management has taken, and we are happy to sort of execute that. Also, what we've done is we've partnered with Oscar Foundation, so we work very closely with Ashok. So you have a lot of young leaders from Oscar Foundation, you know, who love the opportunity to come on board and study sports management and give back to the community where they've come from. So one such case was there last year where Poonam Gautam, one of the young leaders at Oscar Foundation, actually pursued the program at GISB where it was a 50% off scholarship on the tuition, and the remaining we looked at creating fundraising programs and crowdfunding programs for her, so much to the extent that we actually she was actually part of the group that came with us to London for the Premier League visit. Lastly, in a very organic but small way, what we do is we've invested in an amateur girls women's football team called GISB Blue Frames, which plays in the Creators Premier League. It is a small way in which the girls or the women in our program can actually implement what they learn in the program. I mean, not a lot of times you'll get to work with a direct ISL or an I-League team, but you can work with an amateur team where you're managing players, managing sessions, going for matches, doing fan development. You know, the Creators Premier League is played in Mumbai. It's a local tournament with women over here. But that's a small way in which we can create conversation, create dialogue, create stories with women in sport in general. So these are a few points that I thought I'll share out of turn.
That's beautiful, Ruben. That's really nice to know. Levana just wants to ask Amol something.
I just want to add, actually, also Shell, to your point, I played the Creators Premier League. We played against y'all as well. We saw a lot of your fan support and yourself and Neil there. So just saying
that. You've seen the fan development, how we are trying to bring some sort of traction in women's sport in Mumbai. I mean,
sure.
It doesn't necessarily have to impact at a big scale. You can start small in your community. Right?
Absolutely. And also, Amol, right back to you about the point that you added. That's exactly why I shared what I shared, is because it's a story that can really inspire more women to take up sports management as a field of study, as a pursuit, is because I know that not just was I the only Indian in my class all across, but I was just a 21-year-old who started off from scratch in a new country, not knowing anyone. I had to work my way up, get a job in not just local organizations and federations, and you're right about them giving their jobs to their natives, yes. But you've got to take a leap of faith and know that if you really know your stuff, you're going to get out there. And besides that, when Adidas hired me, they have not had one Indian, let alone an Indian woman, working in their creation department. So if success stories take people forward and it comes to women-centric marketing, I hope that's a actionable point of interest there. Thank you.
Thank you, Levana. Our next question is from Surbi. Surbi, yeah, please introduce yourself and what's your question?
Hello all. My question is an open question. Yeah. So, what would our co-host say what sports management is like? It has been answered. But if you could still, you know, add some points to it, what would it be like? What would you say sports management is? And what are the assumptions that one comes into the industry with? And are there any myths about sports management?
What it is, what are the assumptions, and what are the myths? Who can answer this?
Can I start?
Yeah.
So every student who comes to me wants to manage Virat Kohli. That's what sports management is. Okay, so I personally, when we take interviews after our admission test, and why do you want to do sports management? These are the ones who have not played sports. No, I want to manage Virat Kohli. I want to manage him. So they, you know, that's the myth, that sports management is not about being a manager for a sports person. There are a few sports person who are, you know, who can afford to have a manager. So it's you can count them on your fingers. Those are really making sports management is not only about managing a sports person, but it is logistics, it's advertising, finance, anything and everything to do with sports comprises of sports management. As I think Amol said some time back, you should be ready for anything and everything that comes your way, whether it is were taking water during IPL time to the players if it has to be, or whether it is distribution of bibs when it starts. Anything that you work in the sports industry contributes towards your experience. You should not take it lightly. You definitely should not take it lightly. Whatever comes your way is definitely, you know, counted as your experience. Let's take a simple example of bib distribution during a marathon. You do it this year, a junior student does it this year. Next year, the race guy knows it, he's experienced. Never know, you might start climbing up the ladder next year in that company itself. So please be open to whatever comes across your way in terms of being involved in the sports. That's what you should be. As all the panelists have been saying, you should have a passion. You should have a passion for sports. Don't come here looking only for money. Money follows. You work hard. Anywhere you work hard, any industry you work hard, money definitely follows. But don't just, come here doing, I'm going to do a bachelor's, I'm going to do a master's, I'm going to do something abroad and I'll get a 10 lakh, 15 lakh salary. No. Please don't come here. Please definitely don't come here. Be ready to put in the hard work for the first 4 to 5 years. Be ready for anything and everything that comes your way. And once you're established, once the industry knows what you are good, what you're capable, advise all the want to come into sports management. In fact, when people when people ask me whether you guarantee placements, I would say placement is an outcome of what you're able to give back to the industry. You can't do a course and get a placement. It's something that what you can contribute back. Yeah, Amol, please go on. Sorry.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks, Amit. So, Surbhi, first of all, I think I really appreciate that question. That's a very good question to come from a student. And I would encourage every student who's planning to get into sports management to think in a similar way wherein they ask such questions. Amit has already partially answered that question about sports management. And just to add to it, apart from the fact that everyone wants to manage Virat Kohli, they also come with different notions which are incorrect to begin with. They think sports management will help them play sports. And what I tell them is your job is to make everyone play, and the only person who would not be playing is you, because when others play, that is when you make money. So these are some of the things that a student has to understand, and that is probably we try and address during the counseling session. And it could mean sports management could mean different things to different people. So I think Amit has already touched upon it, and I would encourage every student to probably ask such kind of questions which can help you understand the why part of it, as to why do you want to be in sports management. Thanks, Urbi.
Can I add in?
Sure.
Right. Fundamentally, if you take a back step and you're asking what is sports management, right? So how I see it is that sports has two sides, right? One is the technical side and one is the business side. Everything that happens on the other side. So one is the technical side and one is the business side. So technical side is your athletes, sports sciences, all of that. The other side is what I think lies the entire ecosystem of sports management, where you are the one enabling that the technical side of sport runs smoothly. So now I think if you have that fundamental thought in place in your mind, then you look at that ecosystem from a very different lens. Now within that ecosystem, look at where it is that you can add most value to create a difference in the ecosystem, where you are talented and what makes you happy, and you need to combine that together, and that's where you will flourish the most. I think just in a very few words, I just want to share.
We've got one last question from Jimmy Irani. Jimmy Irani basically says that currently the pandemic is going to have an effect on how people are going to view sports management courses. What are you all doing to keep the morale high and keep the parents and future candidates positive? Anyone? Shail, would you like to answer this?
Anjali, I just want to quickly answer Surbhi's question before sure. I come to this one. Yeah. So, Surbhi, I have a question back for you. Okay. In your opinion, who's the fastest man on earth?
Surbhi, unmute yourself. Yeah.
I know Usain Bolt.
Okay, that's so. Yeah, you're right in a way. So that means what you're saying is if Usain Bolt ran in the Mumbai Marathon, he should come first, right?
No.
But you just said he's the fastest man on earth, right? So that,
yeah.
So why I'm illustrating your question with this example is that there is no one answer to what people have in mind when they think of sports management. There isn't, because constantly in the slices of time, things are changing. So maybe somebody's father has too much money. Somebody doesn't want to go and work in his father's company. Somebody doesn't want to sit at home. Somebody doesn't want to go and do some other program. Somebody just wants to be close to sports. There are just too many variables. And as educators, our job is to ensure that we look at everybody individually. And that's the only way we can do justice to their expectations. So you need to, first of all, evaluate what you think. And this is purely specifically for you, is that imagine you only had 3 years to live. Just 3 years to live. And this is a beautiful time to truncate that timeline, right? The problem, the disease of your generation is that you think, you know you're going to die sometime, but you live as if you're going to live forever. It's called the disease of immortality. So think you have only 3 years to live and try to do everything you want to do in those 3 years. That's the most important aspect of life. So that is point number one. Point number two is that when students join sports management, nobody wants to join and do the small things. Nobody wants to start from the lower rungs. Everybody wants to jump and wants to be visible, because everybody has a hole inside them, and they fill their hole with, say, likes on their Instagram profile. They don't want to go to an event just because they want to be in that event. They want to go there so they can tell that story to their friends. Hey, look at this picture. I met this star over there. I took a picture with him. I was like the center of attention. I was looking so good. So all these things, so essentially sports management is nothing more than a kind of psychology expectation. And that is why when someone joins the program and they leave the program, the transformation for some is immense and for some is just a bit. And I think the point which Levana was saying about soft skills, I think all the institutes over the years have evolved to a point where I think soft skills are embedded, because each institute is making these students present every week. They're making them do those kind of things which you would be expected to do in a job. Anjali, what was that last question?
The second question is, how do you keep the morale of parents and students up, particularly after COVID? I mean, if to get in more students or whatever.
Okay. So as the dean of VIFA Skiller Nation, which is the West India Football Association program we've been running for 4 years, I can answer that question. The morale is something which needs to be blindsided. So let me explain what I mean by this. Is that if you tell someone verbally, like things are going to get better, or don't worry, this shall also pass. These don't hit you as hard as you do make them do some activity. So you need to keep yourself busy. And the best way to do it is to give them goals leading to an objective. So the way we define it, a mission. So just Surbhi, this is very important for you also and the person who asked this question, is that take a piece of paper and write down. And this is what we do with the people. Write down what your mission is. Suppose your mission is that I want to feed every hungry person I meet. That means your vision would have a metric. Mission has no metric. Vision would have a metric that I want to feed 20,000 people in the next 3 months. And then you use that to set up an objective and then have these goal milestones. So the answer to the question is that we ensure that all these students are given specific objectives with specific milestones so that their focus is on moving forward and growing as against focusing on the uncontrollables. Because if you try to focus on the things you can't change, you're going to be frustrated. But if you focus on the things in your control, you're always going to feel in control. Anjali? Anjali, you're on mute. You're on mute.
Jimmy, I hope that answered your question. And it's already been 2 hours. Time flies fast when you're having fun. I'm going to just ask everyone to just give me their closing remarks before we end the show. We'll start with you, Shen.
I've already said enough, but I just wanted to thank you, Anjali, for giving me a chance to meet so many people. I don't believe I've ever interacted with Amit, Ruben, Vinit, Amol, or any of these guys. So I think it's a great starting point to probably stay in touch. And also, I hope everything that was shared today was taken as a small spark. Because if we have managed to spark something in you, then reach out to everybody. I think everybody's on LinkedIn. Everybody's available. Reach out to them, because if you try to put a ceiling, oh, if I reach out to them, what if they don't answer? Don't try to think for them. Just reach out. Your job is to throw the ball in the other person's court. What happens next is up to them. So all the best, and I'm sure things are going to be great.
Okay, Shail, thanks so much. Please stay on. I want you to see my movie after this presentation. Yeah, Amit, final words, please. Please unmute.
Anjali, thanks for having over once again. I think it was a fantastic interactive session. I hope the participants have taken something out of whatever knowledge was shared by all the panelists. I hope it helps. And yes, we'll keep on trying whatever that we can do for the industry. And as somebody said, not industry, as somebody said, we should all try and make this an industry. That's something very important.
Ruben?
Right. Firstly, thank you, Anjali, for having all of us represent our respective sports management institutes here. And I completely stand by what I started with, saying that India is a huge country. We still have to become a sporting nation, and we don't need just 10. We need thousands or hundreds of sports management institutes that can provide more learning, more opportunities, create more a bigger industry at large. Coming back to the topic at hand, I feel that since sport is a sunrise sector in India, while participation and consumption is dominated by men, the opportunities that come for on the management side of sports is not looked at gender. So the requirement in sports management is equal at this point for men and women. So I would completely urge all the women, if you are thinking of taking up sports management, please do so, because the industry is growing really fast. Once the COVID situation blows over, there's going to be a huge influx of opportunities within the country. And thank you, everyone, for having me.
Thanks, Ruben. Amol?
So I think, Anjali, thanks to you that we are all able to discuss on a topic which concerns you because of the PIFA Foundation that you run. And I think it's a good platform for us to collaborate, because as Ruben rightly pointed out, I mean, it's time for everyone, each one of us, to collaborate and look out at synergies as well to increase the sports ecosystem, because there is a lot of opportunity, there is a lot of room for growth for everyone. So yeah, I take this opportunity to thank each one of you and look forward to having more such discussions with everyone. Thanks.
And Vineet?
So thanks, Anjali. I think your net worth is invaluable, if not $1 billion, because you were successful. I'm surprised that none of us were on a common platform together previously. So this is one of the first times, and kudos to you for that. Secondly, I'd like to, you know, especially one of the questions that was there, I'd just like to address one point on that, especially on the foreign education part. You know, especially in these uncertain times of COVID and high unemployment in many other countries, you know, there are nationalistic views taken by different governments saying we only want jobs for our people and rest other go back, be it in sports industry or for anyone else. It's a good time, you know, for students from India to look at it that, like the Prime Minister said, you know, the baton of Atmanirbhar Bharat. So that could be something which the students also inculcate here, that let's study in India, settle in India, and let's grow the sports industry in India.
Exactly. And that's pretty much what I am doing with the women's game. I know there are a lot of organizations and institutions and federations doing everything, but like you rightfully said, there is a need for lots of people to do a lot of things. You know, we can't just say, oh, this is not my job or that's not my job. I think PIFA is a fantastic example of how we have done everything in sports management between Nirvansha and myself, whether it's coaching, whether it's managing, whether it's financing, whether it's photography, marketing, and creating webinars and everything else. We've acted as a tour operator company. We've taken 1,400 children abroad, and we've been doing this for 20 years now. And yeah, that's whenever I have an intern who comes to me and says, oh yeah, Anjali ma'am, what do I have to do? I said, you have to do everything. Just watch me. I do everything. You'll have to do everything. Okay, it's as simple as that. So that's exactly what it is. And primarily, sports management needs passion. You have to have the passion. You have to believe that, you know, India does have a fantastic future, and we are all going to be a part of creating this ecosystem where sports is going to become second nature to everybody. I would like to take this opportunity to thank all of you for being on this panel, and especially my technical team, Nirvansha and Neil, and my sponsors, Hefele and Spec. Thank you all very much for being a part of this very informative webinar.